Very good evening, one and all. Welcome to the e-webinar series of Rainbow Children's Hospital, Vijayawada. So today we have another very experienced speaker, internationally renowned Dr. Shirisha Madam. So Madam doesn't require any sort of introduction. She is a hemato-oncologist at Rainbow Children's Hospital, Hyderabad, and she is a visiting consultant at Vijayawada. So Madam has a very vast experience in dealing with hemato-oncology cases. She has done her post-graduation in Chandigarh and fellowship in hemato-oncology at UK. So since last 15 years, she was there. She's there at Rainbow Children's Hospital, Hyderabad, and now she's heading the unit. And she has a very vast experience even in bone marrow transplantations also. So she will be speaking on a very interesting topic. And routinely, we are seeing these cases nowadays, ITP. So what if baby is not responding to steroids, or what is there next to steroids? Also, Madam will speak about that. And we have another very famous speaker. He also doesn't require any introduction. Heartthrob of IIP Krishna, Dr. Vijay. So he is a neonatologist and allergy specialist. He will be speaking on approach to a bleeding neonate. So which is also very one of the very common scenario we see in our day-to-day practice, bleeding neonate. So these are the two topics covered today, and first topic will be by Vijay. Vijay will speak around half an hour, followed by Shirisha Madam for around 40 minutes for ITP. So we have chat box and the question box. So if you have any doubts, you can post this on chat box or question box, and speakers will answer in between the this one talk also. So any questions regarding your not only bleeding neonate or ITP, if you want to, any hematology questions you want to post to Dr. Shirisha Madam, you are free to post that one. Okay, Vijay, you can start the webinar.
First of all, thank you, sir, for that high spoken words. We thank the Rainbow Children's Hospital for providing us the opportunity to be in front of you. There have been like plenty of webinars going on, but seeing the response we are getting, it's been like a very much a happy response for us from you people. So that is driving us to bring forward to you a lot of webinars in the coming days. And as usually, thing is, you can post the questions in the questions part, as said by Dr. Ram Prasad Garu. Before starting this thing, approach to a bleeding neonate, I just want to touch upon a bit basics, because basics are the one, the foundation on which we lay upon anything. I just want you people to watch this video, which will be for around 2 minutes. Of course, it is a lot of basics. We'll just rewind the basics, what we have learned since from our physiology days.
At the site of vessel injury, the first platelets arrive to start sealing the wound. Simultaneously, the coagulation cascade with its various coagulation factors is activated. This involves two pathways, the extrinsic and the intrinsic pathway. Extrinsic activation begins with now exposed molecules of the vessel wall, such as tissue factor, which forms a complex with factor 7, finally leading to the activation of factor 10. This factor 10A is the point at which the extrinsic and the intrinsic pathways of the coagulation cascade meet. The intrinsic pathway consists of various coagulation factors activating each other in a chain reaction. At its end, a complex with an additional cofactor is formed. This complex now activates factor 10. Since the two pathways merge at the level of factor 10A, this factor has a pivotal role in the coagulation cascade. Further down the cascade, factor 10A, in combination with 5A, activates thrombin and induces the so-called thrombin burst. One molecule of factor 10A can catalyze the formation of 1,000 molecules of thrombin. These large amounts of thrombin cause the further activation of platelets and the enhanced formation of fibrin. Fibrin then forms strands, making up the mesh that stabilizes the platelet plug in an arterial clot and holds together the red blood cells in a venous clot. It can be concluded that the central role of factor 10A in the coagulation cascade makes it a viable target for therapeutic intervention in pathologically altered blood.
That's what we have seen in the brief video. Now, for after any insult, the hemostasis, the internal hemostasis, happens through three main phenomena, that is the primary hemostasis, secondary hemostasis, and tertiary hemostasis. The primary hemostasis is mainly because the local factors, that is, the vessel starts constricting, the vascular constriction, so that it prevents the further blood loss from the site or such thing. And then, as we have seen in the video also, the platelets travel to that place, and then the platelets get activated and they adhere to that place. Adherence of the platelets to the vessel wall is through the factor we all know, that is the von Willebrand's factor. And the platelets in turn attach to each other, that is through the fibrinogen. So there is a training cell. The first and foremost thing in the primary hemostasis is a formation of a platelet plug. So once the platelet plug is formed, that has to be like bound together, that has to be stabilized, that has to be made strong, so that it seals off the wound, whatever it is in the thing. So here comes the cascade, that is the coagulation cascade. As we all know, there are two pathways, that is an extrinsic pathway and an intrinsic pathway. The extrinsic pathway is activated by tissue factor involving the factor 7. So mostly, if we have to remember the extrinsic pathway, if you can remember factor 7, that should be sufficient. And for the intrinsic pathway, there is like series of activations like the factor 11, factor 9, factor 8, and then all together by these two, the extrinsic pathway or the intrinsic pathway leads to the common pathway. That is a common pathway for both the things, either extrinsic or intrinsic, that is from the level of factor 10. As we have seen in the previous video also, once a factor 10 is activated, that converts factor 2 to 2A, that is prothrombin to thrombin. This thrombin is the one which further catalyzes the formation of fibrin from fibrinogen. So the fibrin is the one which helps in binding the activated platelets together. So it helps in the formation of the clot. So our formation of our hemostasis will not end at this point. That once the clot has been stabilized or this thing, that has to be lysed. That is your tertiary hemostasis. The tertiary hemostasis, as we all know, fibrin gets converted to fibrin degradation products by the help of the enzyme called plasmin, which is activated by plasminogen. So this is the basic nutshell of all the hemostasis mechanism. So if we remember, the primary hemostasis, secondary hemostasis, and the tertiary hemostasis, each and every one plays a pivotal role in securing the hemostatic pathway. So if you see a very important vitamin which plays a pivotal role is the vitamin K. Vitamin K deficiency leads to hemorrhagic disease of newborn, as we all know. Why is vitamin K important? It is not, we have seen the cascade, coagulation cascade. We haven't seen vitamin K in there. And how come vitamin K has such a pivotal role in this thing is, vitamin K activates the factors like 2, 7, 9, and 10. So if you see the factor 7 from the extrinsic pathway, factor 9 from the intrinsic pathway, factor 10 and 2 from the common pathway. So the vitamin K is pivotal for both the extrinsic pathway and also for the intrinsic pathway and the common pathway factors. So without vitamin K, there are more chances of bleeding. These factors will not be activated. So that is by through gamma glutamyl carboxylation. I don't want to go into that much basics because we all know all those things which has been happening. We just want to brush up the basic things. So this is the normal physiology of the clotting mechanism. So when will a baby or a person lands up with bleeding is if there is any defect in any of the process. So our aim in approach is to identify where the problem is exactly so that we could point our management to that direction. So how a baby, a neonate presents with the bleeding disorder is like any purpura, like the purpuric patches on the body, ecchymotic patches, oozing from the umbilical stump, umbilical cord might fall off, but from the stump it might bleed, and excessive bleeding from the peripheral puncture site, like any cannulation sites or heel prick from the RBS, that they start oozing for a long time. And large cephalhematomas, we don't get any history of back trauma and all such things, but we can see a large cephalhematoma, which is very huge. These are the things which gives us hint towards that we are dealing with some bleeding disorder. Any intracranial hemorrhage without any history of birth trauma and unexplained bleeding in any very low birth weight infant. So these are all the things when we have to think of like evaluating further to find the culprit leading to the bleeding in a baby. And in any bleeding disorder, if we have to progress further, we have to divide into two things. Either if the baby is a well baby or a sick baby. Bleeding in a well unit, I meant a baby is hemodynamically stable. Such a baby is like active, otherwise baby does not have any other symptoms like as such, and the baby is bleeding from any ecchymotic patches and all those things, then we should think of any inherited coagulation disorders. I mean like any inherited factor deficiencies or immune mediated thrombocytopenia. We will see this in the later slides. For if it is a sick preterm neonate, then we are might slightly dealing with a acquired disorder. Could be like our sepsis or a DIC or an NEC. These are all the acquired disorders what we might be dealing with. So there is another thing, pseudo hemorrhage. What we say by pseudo hemorrhage, baby, you can see there is fresh blood coming from the stomach of a newborn. We can't see upper GI bleeding. We don't know whether it is bleeding from the baby or a maternal swallowed blood. Here comes, if it is a maternal swallowed blood which present with the bleeding from the upper GI, then we consider it as pseudo hemorrhage. How we are going to differentiate this from the fetal like a bleeding GI bleeding is through the AP test. The AP test is simple. AP test is fetal hemoglobin is resistant to alkali. The alkali what we use the sodium hydroxide, it is resistant to alkali. So the supernatant pink color which is present, that stays, and the maternal blood or the adult hemoglobin is sensitive to alkali and it changes in the color, that turns to a brown or yellowing color. If the color changes, it is a maternal blood. If the color doesn't change, it is simply bleeding from the baby. So that is the reason it is not actual hemorrhage, it is a maternal swallowed blood. That's the reason why I say it as pseudo hemorrhage in the newborn. So am I clear in that? Next we will go to the approach proper. Like the thing is, the first one is the formation of the platelet. If there is any problem in the platelets, platelet problems could be like decrease in the number, that is thrombocytopenia, or any abnormal function of the platelets, that is thrombocytopathy. How do you know clinically that it is a problem of platelets? That is in typically the bleeding will be like superficial bleeds, not so deep bleeds. Like superficial bleeds, I mean by petechiae, bruising, and any hemorrhage from the mucosal surfaces, or bleeding from a heel stick puncture site, which usually suggests a bleeding from a platelet disorder. The bleeds will not be like prolonged and deep bleeds like these things, which they might be usually presenting in a factor deficiency, the coagulation problem. The severity of thrombocytopenia, once we know that it is a platelet disorder, then we usually get a CBP done and look for the platelet count. Anything less than 150,000, we consider it as thrombocytopenia. And we grade it into mild, moderate, and severe. This grading is important because our further approach depends on what is the severity of thrombocytopenia. So let's see, if it is like 1 lakh to 1 lakh 50,000, we categorize it as mild, and if it is 1 lakh to 50,000, we say it as moderate. Sorry. Less than 50,000, we consider it as severe thrombocytopenia. So let's see. This looks like a very busy thing, but let's simplify these things. So first, we should know whether it is early onset thrombocytopenia or late onset thrombocytopenia. What do we mean by early onset? The onset of thrombocytopenia within 72 hours of life. So if the thrombocytopenia is happening within 72 hours, we consider it as early onset thrombocytopenia. Once it is early onset thrombocytopenia, then we are further dividing it into either a mild to moderate thrombocytopenia or severe thrombocytopenia. You can see here a mild to moderate thrombocytopenia, and that is the platelet count is more than 50,000, and the child is well. That is, the child, as we have seen, either well infant or a sick infant, and the baby is well. We just, if the baby is well and the platelet count is more than 50,000, we just keep on monitoring the baby. If the platelet count is rising, then there is nothing much to do. And if the baby is a sick infant or the thrombocytopenia is severe, the first and foremost thing what we have to see is evaluate for either disseminated intravascular coagulation or sepsis. That we know sepsis by doing a sepsis screen. DIC we do by the PT, AVDT, fibrinogen, FDP. Will come to know if there is signs of DIC or sepsis, we will go according to that. The real challenge comes is if it is an early onset thrombocytopenia with bleeding, the child is sick and there is no signs of DIC or sepsis. So here comes, then we have to look for the other things here. If it is an early onset thrombocytopenia and the child is otherwise well, suppose say we have diagnosed severe thrombocytopenia of 30,000-40,000 on the second day of life. Child is otherwise hemodynamically stable. We can see like heel prick site bleeding. Then we have to think of immune thrombocytopenia or neonatal alloimmune thrombocytopenia. If there is a history of previous affected sibling, then also we should think of alloimmune thrombocytopenia. And one more thing which is very important that we should consider is if there is an in utero ICH, intracranial hemorrhage, in utero IVH, then also we should think of alloimmune thrombocytopenia. What is alloimmune thrombocytopenia? Yeah, we all know what is RH incompatibility. It is on similar lines with RH incompatibility. So what the culprit here is the paternal and platelet antigen will be transmitted to the fetus. Mother will not be having the platelet antigen. So if there is like seeping of the fetal blood, what we know in the RH incompatibility, seeping of the blood, and for the paternal antigens, antibodies will be produced. And these antibodies, unlike to our RH incompatibility, these are IgG antibodies, which will be crossing the placenta and will affect the baby. So the first pregnancy is the one in which the baby is most likely to be affected. So what happens? These antibodies cross and they attack the platelets, and the platelet count in utero starts reducing. Because the in utero platelet count was pretty low, the child may present with in utero intracranial hemorrhages and all those things. Why we should think of alloimmune thrombocytopenia is here the main line of treatment is your IV immunoglobulins. Once we give immunoglobulin, the child will settle off. Even platelet transfusions and all those things will not help much for the baby. So the other possibility is your autoimmune maternal autoimmune disease, like the mother has some SLE or such things, the baby may present with a thrombocytopenia. And if you see the baby is having features of any underlying syndrome like absent radius, that is your thrombocytopenia with absent radii, which is a TAR syndrome, or if you see any manifestations of torch or any underlying symptoms like your hepatosplenomegaly and all those things, then we have to work for the torch or any other genetic anomalies, as I said, like your TAR symptoms which are associated with this. And the other thing is in a preterm baby, where the baby is on central lines, this is not typical for early onset. It is mostly for, most probably for a late onset. And we have to think of central line induced thrombosis leading to thrombocytopenia. So these are all the things what we should look for in early onset thrombocytopenia. Late onset thrombocytopenia is very simple. It is most probably, most of the times, it is because of sepsis, NEC or DIC. If we see thrombocytopenia after 72 hours, then we should think of the lines of sepsis, NEC or DIC. If there is no evidence of sepsis, NEC or DIC, Then we come to all the four things what we have discussed previously. So the first and foremost thing is common things are common. Look for sepsis or DIC. If sepsis DIC are not present, then we have to think of the other causes of thrombocytopenia. So that we have dealt with the primary hemostasis. Now we should think of the secondary hemostasis. Impairment in secondary hemostasis, as I said previously, it results in bleeding from the deep tissues, which will be delayed. And to identify a problem in the secondary hemostasis, we should be doing our favorite test, that is the prothrombin timing and activated partial thromboplastin time and the international normalized ratio. And the PT-FTT-INR is pretty simple, but mark my words, PT-FTT-INR by themselves have pretty much limitations. Like every lab, the lab will have different reference values, and the sample should be a free flow venous sample. And the problem, if it is like a heparinized sample, there will be like a lot of false values will be there. And in preterm babies, and in the preterm babies with lower gestation, because of the immaturity of the liver and the decreased levels of certain clotting factors, normal values of PTFDT will be on the normal, difference values will be on the higher side. You can see here, if it is around less than 28 weeks, the normal reference range for the PTFDT is around more than 21 and more than 65. Where it is, if it is a term infant, it will be more than 16 and more than 55. But see, these are all like vary from lab to lab. Lab reference values must be in place. And INR is the one which acts as a standard, and INR for deciding any clotting abnormality is also pretty high in preterm babies. Like for right to preterm babies with less than 28 weeks, we can wait up to INR up to 3 also before jumping on and giving any FFP transfusions at all. So let's now club all these three things, like our platelet count, PT and APTT, and try to come to a conclusion on what we are dealing with, that is what is the problem and how we are going to approach that thing. So we have three values with us. We have a platelet count, we have a PT, and we have a APTT. And now, as I said, in any bleeding disorder, we see whether the baby is a well baby or a sick baby. The baby is a well baby. Now we're dealing with a well baby. Normal platelet count, normal PT, normal APTT. So what we are dealing with here, but the baby is bleeding, a well baby, the normal platelet count, normal PT and normal APTT, but with bleeding tendencies. Any guesses? It is, as I said previously, thrombocytopathies. Like here, the platelet count will be normal, but the function of the platelets will be abnormal. What we say, we all know, as I said, platelet adhesion and aggregation defects. It is a Bernard-Soulier and Glanzmann's thrombocythemias. These are the ones, of course, which are very, very rare. So this is the next one. Platelet count is reduced, but PT-FTT are normal. Well baby, as we discussed in the thrombocytopenia section, well baby with normal PT and normal APTT with a decreased platelet count, most probably we are dealing with immune thrombocytopenia. And now the other extreme, now the platelet counts are normal, but PT is prolonged and APTT is prolonged. So PT is a marker of extrinsic pathway. APTT is a marker of intrinsic pathway. So if both PT and APTT are prolonged, we are dealing with the factors involving either both the pathways or the factors in the common pathway. So what we know exactly previously, we were discussing with the vitamin K. Vitamin K involves four factors, that is your 2, 7, 9, and 10, which involves both the things. So in a well baby with normal platelet count, with elevated PT and elevated APTT, we are most likely dealing with vitamin K deficiency bleeding, that is your hemorrhagic disease of newborn. So the next scenario, here only PT is increased. So now by this time we are clear, PT increased, what you are dealing with a congenital factor deficiencies, most probably it is factor 7 deficiency. And platelet count is normal, PT is normal, APTT is prolonged. So we are dealing with the factors involving with the intrinsic pathway, that is factors like factor 8, factor 9, in factor 11. So these are all the deficiencies. So now go to the other extreme, that is a sick baby. Now we are dealing with a sick baby with abnormalities in the platelet count, PT or APT. If you can see here, if all the things are normal, the platelet count is normal, PT is normal, APT is normal, then we are dealing with an altered vascular integrity. Like conditions like hypoxia, preterm and asbestosis, these are the things where we see altered vascular integrity, where the all the things will be normal, but baby will be sick and baby will be bleeding. We come to the other extreme, like where all the things are abnormal. The platelet count is decreased, PT is increased and APT is increased. That is straightforward, straight clear for all of us. That is your consumptive coagulopathy, that is your DIC. And if platelet count is normal with increased PT and APT. So here what we are dealing with, factor deficiencies, of course it is an acquired. What is acquired thing? Most probably some liver disease, where the liver is damaged, where the factors responsible for clotting are not being produced. Or if it is a very severe vitamin K deficiency bleeding, where it presents with severe ICH and all these things, where the child may be sick. And if only platelet count is reduced and your PT FDTs are normal, then we know it is straightforward, whether dealing with some case of either sepsis or NAC. So if we can understand the basics, keep the basics intact, then we might come to a conclusion with based on the platelet count and the PT and APTT will give us some reasonable idea what we are dealing with. If it is like thrombocytopenia, the bleeding because of thrombocytopenia, and if it is not alignment thrombocytopenia, the management is quite simpler. We might need platelet transfusions. Of course, there are like quite various cutoffs for platelet transfusions, like liberal ways and restrictive ways. Ideally, what we follow our unit is less than 30,000. With the sick babies, we try to transfuse the babies. And if the baby is pretty much bleeding and platelet counts, we like put a bit on the higher side, like around 50,000. If the baby is bleeding very profusely, then we can transfuse the baby. And if we see that PT-APTT is prolonged, PT is prolonged, then we have to think for factor assays. If we are dealing with some congenital problems, we have to deal with the factor assays has to be sent. And FFP, based on those things, FFP 10 to 15 ml per kg, we will deal with the acute crisis. And if we see if his baby is dealing with like vitamin K deficiency baby, that is the one which is like very important, which is very much preventable. Nowadays, we are rarely seeing a case of vitamin K deficiency bleeding. Of course, like we do see one or two cases in the PICUs. With the prophylactic use of vitamin K, the vitamin K deficiency bleeding, that cases of vitamin K deficiency bleeding has proportionately decreased. We all know that vitamin K, VKDB is mainly of three types. It presents very early in the first 24 hours. We call it as early. It's mainly because of any maternal drugs. Classic, that is between 1 to 7 days. It is because of exclusively breastfed babies who are not given any vitamin K at birth. Late is between 1 week to 8 weeks. That is because the baby is not absorbing the vitamin K, whichever is given to the baby. So diagnosis of vitamin K deficiency bleeding. Here, what is more important is in vitamin K deficiency bleeding, both PT and APTT will be prolonged, as I said previously. But compared to APTT, PT is much more prolonged because of the dynamics involving factor 7. To diagnose as VKDB, PT should be prolonged more than 4 times the control value. And as I said previously, we have brought to our flow chart, the platelet count should be normal. Fibrinogen will be normal and the FDP will be absent. Fibrin degranulation products will be absent. And if you give a IV vitamin K, because the factors are already present, they are not activated. If you give vitamin K intravenously, it starts activating the precursors. So once these factors activate and the PT values will normalize within 20 minutes to 30 minutes. This by itself will give us a diagnosis that we are dealing with a vitamin K deficiency bleeding. Of course, PVK levels, that is protein induced vitamin K absence levels, is the one which is going to give us some light on the diagnosis that we are dealing with VKDB. So with these things, I will end my talk. If there are any questions, as said, we will take in the last. I hand over the session to Sirisham.
Thank you, Dr. Vijay. And thank you, Dr. Ram Prasad, for your kind introduction. I'm happy to be part of this academic program and then share our ideas in treating this bleeding neonate or ITP and all. So that was an excellent overview of hemostasis in a neonate and then approach by Dr. Vijay. Now we'll move on to a session on ITP. Can you see my screen?
Yeah, ma'am, we can see it now.
Okay, fine. I'll go ahead then. Okay, so these are the various difficult scenarios what we face in our hematology, in our day-to-day pediatric practice related to hematology. And one of those difficult or challenging scenario what we face is thrombocytopenia, other than anemia, bleeding, thrombosis, and certain infiltrative or metabolic disorders or HLH or immunodeficiency, etc. So thrombocytopenia is one of the important challenge, and out of among them, ITP is the most common scenario what we all see. So let's look at, this is the outline of our discussion, like definition, pathophysiology, investigations, and then we'll discuss few typical presentations and then atypical presentation and bit of touch on chronic ITP, but I'm not going into details of chronic ITP. At the end, we can discuss like if there are any questions. So just looking at the introduction, this is the most common cause of acute onset of thrombocytopenia. It's an acquired bleeding disorder, as we know, and it is defined as when the platelet count is less than 1 lakh. So as we know, like platelet count of less than 1 lakh is defined as ITP, and incidence can be up to 1 in 10,000. But if you look at, like, even if you take mild or moderate thrombocytopenia also into consideration, it can be as high as 1 in 1,000 also. And this is common age group for presentation will be around 1 to 4 years, and majority of them will have history of preceding viral illness prior to onset of ITP. Around 2/3 of the cases will have preceding viral illness, but all of them may not have. And there are various viruses described for the etiology, and among them the EBV is most common one. And there is also a concept on in children, like with association with H. pylori infection or post MMR vaccine, it can get triggered. But it's the concept, but just because of this, like with this point, we should not go out with the message that, you know, we should not give MMR, because as we all know, if we weigh benefits and risks, definitely MMR vaccine we have to go ahead and give. And ITP is more commonly seen in late winter or spring, as the as we just finished the viral illness, then the onset of ITP starts. It can be atypical in presentation also. We'll look at the scenarios. Always you may not look at like child who had few weeks prior had a viral illness and then now coming with skin bruises, petechiae, otherwise normal clinical examination, happy, playful child. So that kind of typical presentation you may not get, and then at times you can get atypical presentation also. And main mechanism, as we know, like it's an autoantibody mediated with destruction in the spleen. Not only in the spleen, destruction can also occur outside the spleen. It can be primary without or idiopathic without any reason, or it can be underlying secondary to systemic illness like SLE or with underlying immunodeficiency. Especially when you're looking at chronic ITP, you need to rule out these possibilities. As we know, like, you know, now everything is served for us in the plate, like, you know, in this era, like we have everything in hand, like smartphones to search in a minute. You can reach any topic, read about it and get to know. But in the past, if you look at the history, it was always a struggle to even know that it is an ITP. So I thought like we'll just little bit touch base on the ITP history. It was first described in 1735. If you can recollect, then ITP is also called as Verloff disease because it was first described by Paul Verloff in a lady who had multiple bruises. It was not labeled as ITP, but they thought that, okay, multiple bruises in an otherwise well individual, there is a problem, but it's not a serious problem. So it was first recognized at that time. Later they described the platelets and then role of platelets in hemostasis in 1881. Then first platelet count was performed in an ITP patient in 1889. And the one of the breakthrough event that happened is in 1916, Paul Kanzelson, who implicated excessive destruction of platelets in the spleen, that has led him to force his mentor or surgeon to do splenectomy for a woman who had an ITP. So that was successful. And then they know that, okay, splenectomy is one of the options for ITP. I always wonder, like, you know, what if it would have been in a individual who don't respond 1/3, because splenectomy is not successful in all. Splenectomy is successful only in 2/3 of patients. So luckily that lady was in that 2/3, and then they detected that, you know, splenectomy is useful and it's one of the good modality of treatment. And later, of course, there are indications that it has to be only used in chronic ITPs, and then we'll come to that discussion later. And breakthrough experiment happened in 1951. One of the student injected platelets, ITP patient platelets into his own blood, and then detected that, yes, there is a destruction in a normal individual. When you inject the autoantibodies, you can destroy your own platelets. That happened in 1951, and that has introduced like immunosuppressive therapy later on, using corticosteroids and other immunomodulatory drugs, and later in immunoglobulins and anti-D and monoclonal antibodies, TP was all evolved. So that was like the history, which is interesting. I thought I just shared. This is the pathophysiology. So your production is normal, your chain of production is normal, but they are getting attacked by autoantibodies, which are like, you know, triggered by T cell. B cell produces autoantibodies, and then that gets attached to the platelet receptors, GP2B3A and GP1B and 9. So, and subsequently they get attached to Fc receptors in the spleen, and that gets destroyed. So that's a pathophysiology. And this exposure, this happens, autoantibody phenomena can happen secondary to various stimulation that can occur in the body, as you can see in the next picture. So before we jump on to ITP, the most important thing what we always need to think of is like, is it a true thrombocytopenia or spurious thrombocytopenia? You have done the bloods for some routine checkup or some other purpose, and then you found that there is a low platelet count. So you always have to go ahead and call your pathologist, ask for a complete manual examination of the smear so that you can see clumps like what has been demonstrated in the picture. This clumping is mainly because of the presence of EDTA within the vial, as well as also because of the mechanical force that can get generated while withdrawing the blood or while injecting the blood into the vial. So various factors that can cause clumping. So we should be aware of this, and then we have to look at the manual count. So coming to important part, that is clinical symptoms. So you can divide ITP into mild, moderate, severe class, or class 1, 2, 3, 4. So in mild, there is either no bleeding or milder form of bleeding manifestations like skin bruises, ecchymotic patches, whereas in moderate, you can have a significant epistaxis, menorrhagia, mucosal bleeding spots, and extensive skin bleeding manifestations with an impending mucosal bleeds. Whereas in class 4 or severe form of bleeding manifestations in ITP, you get life-threatening bleeding like severe mucosal bleeds, dropping the hemoglobin, requiring blood products, etc. Or it can be severe menorrhagia requiring the similar line of management, or it can be intracranial bleed, which is a life-threatening, and then we have to act very fast. So as you can see in the picture, like, you know, it can be skin or extensive mucosal, or it can be palatal, or maybe just a few bruises, or can be IC bleed. So how do we diagnose? As we all know, like right from our MBBS days, we always know that good history, thorough clinical examination is the key for most of the things. Here, along with that, you need a complete blood picture, mean platelet volume, and peripheral smear as well. So up to this, like if you are definitely confident, American Society of Hematology 2011 as well as 2019 guidelines says that you don't need bone marrow examination. However, as we all know, in our country, like in remote places, there is no access for expert comments on peripheral smear. So majority of them depend on the machine for the platelet count, and infiltrative disorders can get missed out, and then if we use steroids, that can cause problems. Hence, for uniformity, in India, majority of us, we do bone marrow and then start the steroids. But if you are using only IVIG, bone marrow examination is not required. You can go ahead and give IVIG, and then later you can consider bone marrow if required if you are starting steroids. What is the role of antiplatelet antibodies in these children? So role of antiplatelet antibodies, if you have, I mean, it is highly sensitive but not specific. So going by that, it is not routinely done. So you can stop at first four levels like history, examination, CBP, mean platelet volume, which will be good or high on higher side with good peripheral smear examination, that is having mega platelets in the smear and normal WBC morphology. So that is the requirement to call it as ITP. Bone marrow examination, what do you see in bone marrow? So you will have a normal megakaryocytes or increased number of megakaryocytes with haplobit forms, or you can have normal megakaryocytes also. That indicates that platelet production is normal, so you are destroying in the periphery. Other cell lines also will be normal as expected, that is erythroid series and myeloid series. So coming to terminology that is used in ITP. So one is going by time frame, you call them as newly diagnosed ITP within 3 months. Persistent ITP, 3 months to 1 year. Chronic ITP, beyond 1 year. This has been designed in 2007. Definitions have been revised. Before that, less than 6 months acute ITP, more than 6 months chronic ITP. But it has been revised in 2007 for simple reason that some of the newly diagnosed ITPs, that is, that starts as an acute ITP, have spontaneous recovery within 1 year. That's why they, instead of using the chronic as a terminology, they have revised it into persistent ITP, and then they have seen that some of them go into spontaneous remission without any treatment, and some of them can go into chronic ITP, which is around 20% in children, and the number can go up in adolescents or young adults. So the other terminology what we should know in ITP is no response, some response, or response, complete response. No response is absence of increment of your platelets to double from the baseline, that is at presentation, within a week of treatment. Some responses like you are doubling the platelet from the baseline within a week of treatment. Complete response is going beyond 1 lakh within a week of starting treatment. So the principles of treatment, as we all know, like, you know, there is no bleeding or minor skin bleeding manifestations in ITP. Parents understand that, yes, ITP is not a major problem. They understand that when to report, like in case of bleeding manifestations or other problems, if they know that they have to report immediately to physician, you can always go for wait and watch rather than rushing with the treatment. So we always need like more than 20,000-30,000 platelets to maintain hemostasis. So if you see around 20,000-30,000 platelets, and their understanding is good, they are within the medical reach, and they do report to you on time, one can also one can counsel them for wait and watch policy rather than rushing with the treatment. Whereas if you have extensive skin bleeding manifestations with or without mucosal bleeds, then we know that, you know, straight away we go ahead with the treatment, but generally we would like to go ahead with steroids in that cases. Whereas if you have life threatening bleeds, that is, which is defined as severe mucosal bleeds, either from gut or from severe menorrhagia in adults and girls. So there you are in a hurry to improve the platelet count there, or it IC bleed. So there you have to go for IVIG. Failure of first line medications like steroids, IVIG, anti-D. Then we go for rituximab and TPOs. I'll come to that. And the splenectomy is indicated only for chronic ITP. So steroids, I think steroids, IVIG, anti-D, TPOs, rituximab, these are the medications what routinely use. So you just, this is a busy table which shows, like, you know, what is the dose of IVIG, what is the dose of steroids, what are the different regimens one can choose, like prednisolone, if you are giving for 7 days and then slow tapering over next 3 weeks. Or you are choosing pulse methylpred, so what should be the schedule? Whereas if you are giving anti-D, what is the dose and what is the onset of action and all? So this table indicates that. So just going back to the previous slide. So steroids acts in three, four mechanisms are there for steroids. One of them is like, you know, it inhibits the Fc receptors in the spleen. Hence, it can reduce the destruction or attracting the antibody platelet complex onto the Fc receptor. And it stabilizes, first action is it stabilizes the mucosa and mucosal membrane. So a child presents to you with the oral bleeding manifestation. So you have started steroids. Next day when you see the oral bleeding spots disappear, but platelet count is still same. So that means like, you know, there is a mucosal stabilization, the membrane stabilization that has happened, but count has is yet to increase because that takes few more days. So mucosal stabilization or membrane stabilization, then Fc receptor inhibition, and through anti-lymphocytic action, it forms less antibodies. So there are various mechanisms through which steroids acts, and then it takes at least 5 days, 4 to 5 days for steroid to act. At times you do see early response, but generally you have to wait 5 to 7 days before you say that steroid has not helped. But however, before rushing to next drug, you have to always think like, do I need to go to next drug or is the child stable? Can I wait? So going by that, you have to choose like whether you want to go to next drug or not. So then other drug, what you use in newly diagnosed or acute ITP is IV immunoglobulins. As I said, like IVIG, as you can see in this table, it is as per ASH guidelines, 0.8 mg/kg. Previously, it was 2 g/kg, but now 1 g/kg is also enough. So within 24 to 48 hours, you do get the response. Wherever you are in a hurry, like life-threatening bleeds, there you have to go ahead with IVIG so that you can improve the count in a faster way. And the duration of action will be there for 2 to 3 weeks. And then after that, if the child doesn't go into spontaneous remission with the autoimmune process, it can recur, ITP can recur again. So one can choose to go back onto IVIG if the family wish to do so, or you can do bone marrow and go ahead and start steroids. In the beginning, if you have chosen only IVIG and you got the good response and you don't want to start steroids, or you have not done BMA and you don't want to start steroids, or even family doesn't want to start steroids, some of them will have their own reservation to start steroids. In that case, if the child bleeding manifestations are under control and platelet count, there is at least some response, then we can go ahead and wait and see at the end of 2 to 3 weeks what happens. Is there a recurrence? Then do I need to go back onto IVIG or should I go ahead with the steroids is the decision. One can go ahead and make it at that point of time. So if your IVIG and steroids are not working, then you have to go ahead with the anti-D. Anti-D, now current recommendation is 75 microgram per kg, single dose. So you have to be Rh positive. So you have, unless otherwise you are Rh positive, it doesn't work. What is the mechanism of action? Anti-D goes and binds to RBC. So as we know, like, you know, anti-D go, when they are Rh positive, anti-D goes and binds to RBC, and anti-D and RBC complex goes and exhausts the Fc receptors in the spleen. Because of that, platelet and antibody gets diverted. So as they are getting diverted, there is an increase in the platelet count. So anti-D is acting indirectly and then exhausting the Fc receptor so that platelet count increases. How does IVIG act? It has a direct action. It will go and directly get attached to Fc receptors and then exhaust the Fc receptors. So it competitively inhibits the Fc receptor so that your antibody platelet complex is getting diverted. And there are several other mechanisms. It gives negative feedback to further autoantibody, it acts through complement. So there are several mechanisms, but the what I said is like important mechanism, what we should remember. So we go ahead and choose first steroids, if required even IVIG, that is like where we choose IVIG. I'm just going to say now. So IVIG, when do you choose? If you have severe mucosal bleeds, or if you have IC bleed, or you have started steroids to begin with and then child is a non-responder, or infants just started walking and have severe thrombocytopenia. In that case, like you have a worry that, you know, they can get into IC bleed. So So there also one can go ahead and choose, or you are facing a neonatal severe thrombocytopenia where you don't want to use steroid. So in that case also one can go ahead and use IVIG. So anti-D, non-responder to steroids, or rituximab, refractory to steroids. This is 2011 guidelines. If you are refractory to steroids, IVIG, anti-D, you can choose rituximab. If you are, but latest guidelines 2019, if you are refractory to all the above medication, then you have to choose TPOs. Okay, so thrombopoietin stimulators, so we have to go ahead and choose so that we can go ahead and get the better response. So that we'll go move on to quickly move on to case scenarios. This is a typical case. So we don't get always like typical case like this, but this is a typical case where 5 years old boy came with extensive PTK all over the body with a few skin bruises and few palatal PTK. There is a history of viral infection 3 weeks prior to presentation. Otherwise, the normal physical examination, and there is no significant family history of past history of bleeding manifestations or family history of bleeding manifestations and all. Here, hemoglobin is normal, WBC differentials are normal, and as expected, platelet count is low. So it's a straightforward case, and you know that you have to treat this because count is very low, and then as extensive, though they are skin, but there are also palatal PTK, hence you go ahead and treat it. So whereas if you look at the next scenario, which is there on the other side, this is a 1 year old boy who came with a, who developed fever few days prior, 3-4 days prior. He had just fever for a day and acute gastroenteritis, and he was developmentally normal, born to non-consanguineous couple. And he developed after fever subsided on third day, he developed bruises all over the body and melena. On examination, when he came to us, he had mild pallor, but in the referral hospital, he had severe pallor. He had platelets of 9,000, hemoglobin was 5, he had severe pallor. So he had acute febrile illness followed by bleeding from GI as well as skin manifestations. Had severe anemia as well as severe very severe thrombocytopenia. And he received platelets and PRBC prior to coming to us. Hence, when we saw him, he had mild pallor and then HB of 9. Platelets were still very low, 8,000. So despite of platelet transfusion, so that itself indicates that within 24 hours, if you are not showing any increment for your single donor platelet transfusion, then definitely it indicates that there is a destruction process that is going on. So this is not a typical case of ITP, but even though you don't need always like few weeks to stimulate the autoimmune process. At times it can start along with the infection. Para-infectious association also can be there. So we should be aware of, like, so if you look at the peripheral smear, presence of megaplatelets, normal WBC morphology, normal clotting, normal other biochemistry, all these things indicates that yes, this is an ITP. And you can get a doubt that, okay, we do see so many ITPs with less than 10,000, but they don't get into melena. But this child has acute gastroenteritis. So it was an inflamed mucosa. So from inflamed, if you have any trigger anywhere in the body, inflamed mucosa or gastric ulcer or anything like that, from there you can have significant bleed, and then scenario can change like this. And then you have to be very careful in your peripheral smear examination. So this is a scenario related to CNS bleed. This young girl of 11 years, born to non-consanguineous parents, no significant past history, developed multiple skin bruises and then oral bleeds and epistaxis a couple of days prior to presentation. And then on the day of presentation, she came to ER with focal seizures, and her HB, WBC differential count was normal, but platelet count was 11,000 for her. And then PTA-PTT were normal. CT had revealed clear parenchymal bleed. So we get the doubts like, how do I approach CNS bleed in these children? So what is the incidence? Do I need to worry? So if you see almost 1,000 ITPs, 500 to 1,000 ITPs, you may see one CNS bleed. The incidence is less than 0.3 or less than 0.5%. So it is very rare. So however, we should be aware like how we have to go ahead and treat it. You have to be aggressive with the platelet transfusion because you want to limit the disability you have to be aggressive with IVIG, 1 gram per kg. Immediately you have to go ahead and start because you want to improve the platelet count as soon as possible. And you also have to go ahead parallelly with steroids because you don't know, like if IVIG is not working, at least steroids will start working and then there will be some stabilization. So going by that, you have to be aggressive in these kind of scenarios. You have to be cautious when they develop into go into chronic ITP in these cases. So in fact, this child has gone into chronic ITP, but we had to give medications to maintain her platelet count above 30,000-40,000 to keep it in the safe level so that she doesn't get into another bleed. So that is another thing what we should be careful in these children. And some of the ITPs can behave so tough that it starts as an acute ITP. They do show response to IVIG steroids and they can go into chronic ITP. Usually chronic ITP, we always counsel parents and always we say like, you know, treat the child, not the number. So that definitely holds true. Even in this case, this child was getting into repeated episodes of severe mucosal bleeds and she required two ICU admissions. She had severe malina epistaxis. She was swallowing the blood, was throwing it out like a hematemesis. So some of them can behave in such a severe manner, but some majority of them will have simple bleeds like skin bruises or on and off mucosal bleeds or menorrhagia. So that kind of situation you do see, but some of them can have a tough course requiring all kind of second line medications and even surgical interventions and all. So coming to neonatal ITP, just want to share one case very quickly. Like this is a young baby who had ongoing dropping thrombocytopenia over a period of few days and then required platelets in between. IVIG was given in the first week and then showed transient improvement of the platelet count from 13,000 to 30,000, again started dropping. So in these kind of situations, majority of the neonatal ITPs, they don't behave like this. They will have moderate thrombocytopenia. You follow them for some time, they will not have any bleeds. They don't require any intervention. At the most, you may have to give just one dose of IVIG. But here, this baby, because of repeatedly platelet count going down to 10 to 15,000 skin manifestations. So baby required platelet transfusion as well as IVIG. And later even we have to go on to low dose steroid in the third week. So here the questions that come into our mind is, do I need to do bone marrow? When you look at the peripheral smear, your platelets look healthy. You have seen mega platelets. Your MPV is good. And WBC morphology is good, then you don't need to go ahead with the bone marrow. You can always wait patiently and then see the clinical course. So if you don't see healthy platelets, to rule out CAMT, congenital amegakaryocytic thrombocytopenia, probably you may want to go for bone marrow, but definitely that can wait for some time before you go ahead with the bone marrow. And should I give platelet transfusion in these cases or not? Definitely no. As long as you have access for IVIG, you can definitely go ahead and give IVIG rather than going ahead with the platelet transfusion in these children. Of course, this baby received outside and then came to us, but when baby dropped to early teens, that's a different issue. But in general, there is no role of platelet transfusion in these children. And there is, what is the role of steroids? If they are having persistent, very severe thrombocytopenia, like here, like, you know, your count is around 10 to 15,000 and not responding, or a transient ill-sustained response to IVIG, probably you can start, but you have to start a half of the dose, that is 1 mg per kg for a short period, and then you can taper quickly and stop it. And there is no role of other medications, what we use in bigger children, definitely there is no role. And how long I will continue steroids? As I said, like, you know, you don't continue for three weeks, 4 weeks in these children. You give for a week and then you give a taper next week and then see what is the count and then take a call whether to give or not. So as we know, like autoimmune process can transmitted autoimmune process from the mother can be there in baby's system for 6 to 8 weeks. So going by that, until then, they may need support if they go into very severe thrombocytopenia with some bleeding manifestation like this baby. So I just want to share very quickly atypical presentation also. So this is a child who has come from Kakinada, history of fever for 2 days, subsided within few days, and then after a week, parents notice that there are some bruises, mild anemia, mild leukopenia or normal WBC, you can say, with severe thrombocytopenia of 28,000. In Kakinada, they thought of ITP, rightly, and then bone marrow was done. Result, I'll come to that. So when dad came to us, he did not reveal anything. He just told that there are bruises and this is the platelet count. I have come for evaluation. So I told, like, we will repeat the CBP, we'll see the smear. If there are atypical cells, definitely we have to go ahead and do the bone marrow. If you are from local, then we can wait. If you are from, since you are away, we have to go ahead with the bone marrow. Maybe we can go ahead with the steroids if you cannot come back for follow. So all those options were discussed with him. And then slowly he revealed that bone marrow revealed evidence of acute leukemia in Kakinada. Hence, I have come for second opinion here. So we did the repeat bone marrow and it was acute lymphoblastic leukemia. So sometimes you can have a normal WBC, peripheral smear may not show atypical cells, for which 99% of them will have atypical cells, but 1 or 2% may not have atypical cells. And you can get the scenarios like this, but still the recommendation is, like, if you have a very good peripheral smear with thorough clinical examination and history suggestive of ITP, one can go ahead and choose the steroid. But as I previously mentioned, for uniformity, so we always go ahead and do the marrow and then only do the start the steroid. So that is the importance of this case, what I just demonstrated. So the another few more atypical cases I just want to share. This is a 5-year-old boy who, while playing in the school, that is like pre-corona era where kids were playing in the school happily. So in those days, like when child fell and injured the chin, they noticed that child was continuously oozing from the skin, chin, and then they did the CBP, noticed thrombocytopenia, referred as ITP to us, and then we saw that there are occasional atypical cells, not very typical of blast, but definitely they were looking suspicious. So when we did the bone marrow, he also turned out to be acute lymphoblastic leukemia. And you can see in the picture, it's not the picture of the same child, but just for the discussion, I've downloaded. So there is another boy who had a routine blood test done. So father has a like yearly checkup. So during that time, entire family, they get the checkup done. And then when they did the bloods, he had thrombocytopenia, moderate thrombocytopenia was there. And they thought it is probably ITP, and they waited for a few weeks, and then it was going down. And on clinical examination, he had just firm posterior auricular nodes. Other than that, there were no other significant findings. And then when we looked at the smear, it showed suspicious cells and turned out to be acute leukemia. So what are these atypical presentation telling us is, like, you know, we have to be very careful in physical examination, because we don't tend to generally see posterior auricular, and we have to be very thorough in our peripheral smear examination. And one can also go for the IPF, immature platelet fraction. High IPF indicates that it is more likely ITP. So another atypical case is, like, you know, it's a young boy, 15 months boy, who came with acute fibrinolysis a few weeks prior, typical ITP kind of scenario, came with low platelets, and he was heavily bleeding, epistaxis, malina, required blood products, but stabilized in few days with the IVIG steroids, and got discharged. His second admission after 2 weeks was with severe diarrhea, dehydration, acidosis, requiring ICU stay after initial stabilization in the ER. And again, no organomegaly, no lymphadenopathy. And that time had normal platelets because he was under treatment. But screening as part of ICU protocol, like, you know, for everyone when they go to ICU, they do the HIV, and HIV was positive for this child. So in adults, for all the cases, they do HIV. But I think, like, you know, even in pediatric, probably it's worthwhile doing HIV, but it's not a standard recommendation to do HIV for all ITPs. But maybe, it, like, you know, occasionally we see these kind of scenarios and it is worth doing. So this is another child who had diagnosed as ITP from 1.5 to 2 years of age. Bone marrow also, like, was done, hemodilute sample, hematopoiesis, what is orderly in that marrow, He received outside on and off steroids, but poor ill-sustained response. He came to us around 3-3.5 years of age. At that time, like we did the bloods, and it showed very severe thrombocytopenia. Repeat bone marrow showed reduced megakaryocytes. That triggered the possibility that it could be inherited marrow failure syndrome. And when we sent the genetics, I think it's not clearly seen, but you can notice that, you know, he had a homozygous mutation for congenital amegakaryocytic thrombocytopenia. CAMT was the diagnosis, and we transplanted this child. This child is also from Kakinada belt, and then he's completely doing fine now post-transplantation. It was a mismatch transplant, 8x10 mismatch transplant, and he had luckily he had uneventful course post-transplant, and then he's doing well now. So this is on right side, this is another atypical presentation. So this is a young boy who had family born to consanguineous couple, elder brother died of hematological problem. This child had ongoing thrombocytopenia from the early age, and at 7 years he started having other problems like anemia and neutrophil count. You can see that, you know, it is very low, so it's a neutropenia and all those problems. So at that time, definitely you have to go ahead and do thorough physical examination. You don't always get the typical picture like this, so you should have high index of suspicion to pick up Fanconi. So this is a child with Fanconi, actually the right side scenario. So Fanconi can have, to begin with, they can have only thrombocytopenia, and then later they can go into other problems like pancytopenia. So this is just a picture to demonstrate that you may not get always all the physical findings or clear cut picture, but having high index of suspicion for atypical presentation is important to pick up the other diagnosis for thrombocytopenia. So this is another referral for thrombocytopenia, where they call for very low platelets, like 37K. And when we looked at the, and this child had, they came with LRTI and had bloods done. In that, they noticed that thrombocytopenia is very severe. Other cell lines were affected, but not that much. So when we looked at the chest X-ray, the density of the bones in the X-ray were like different. So then we got the long bone X-ray done, and that clinched the diagnosis of osteopetrosis. This is another interesting scenario. Definitely, you all have to register. This is a 12 years old girl diagnosed as ITP at around a year prior to presenting to us. And this child had platelets at diagnosis of 28,000. Started on steroids outside and had partial response. Platelets went up from 28 to 40,000 or so. Continued with occasional skin bruises, but child stopped the steroids because platelets have improved to little bit to 40,000, 50,000, and then she was having only skin bleeds. So she the parents decided that, you know, they will stop the treatment, which is fair. And then majority of the scenarios they do go like this. But at 12 years, when she attained menarche, she had severe menorrhagia. So at that time, because of severe bleeding, she had drop in hemoglobin to 6. Platelets were moderate thrombocytopenia, that is 48 to 50,000. So despite of having decent platelets like 40 to 50,000, why she was having severe menorrhagia, we did the bleeding time. That was significantly prolonged, 11 minutes, and then that clinched the diagnosis of Bernard-Soulier syndrome. So in platelet, so even Bernard-Soulier syndrome to begin with can present as an ITP, and then later, because of the clinical suspicion, what you have, if you correlate to the entire scenario, you can pick up that it is a different diagnosis rather than ITP. So these are the other scenarios where, you know, we have, this is another scenario where definitely I would like to just share very quickly. This is a young boy who presented at 11 months with repeated URTIs and severe thrombocytopenia, treated with steroids as he had extensive skin bleeding manifestations. So, he improved little bit to moderate thrombocytopenia, severe to moderate it got converted to. But he, from 1.5 to 2 years onwards, he started developing rash over the cheeks and elbows, and it's an eczematous kind of rash. And if you look at his MPV, it was low, 5. So what is your diagnosis? Majority of you can answer this question, I think. So in a boy who had started with repeated respiratory tract infection, but not lower, but upper, with ongoing moderate thrombocytopenia, with eczema, with low MPV. So I think needless to say, it's a diagnosis is Wishcott-Aldrich syndrome. So this is just to touch base on chronic ITP. Now current guidelines, more than 1 year, you call it as chronic ITP. Previously it was more than 6 months, but currently you call it as chronic only when it is more than 1 year. You always have to rule out underlying primary immunodeficiency disorders in young children. So CVIDs, Wishcott-Aldrich syndromes, hyper IgE syndrome, and certain variants of SCID if they are not very severe and not presenting in the young age. So those kind of things can present initially like an ITP, and then later they go on to develop frank manifestations of immunodeficiency disorder, like what you have seen in this case. That's initially started like ITP. And then typically for Wishcott-Aldrich, the eczema starts after 1 year, 1 to 2 years, they develop eczema, and then later they also drop immunoglobulin syndrome. So we did even mutation analysis for this child and then diagnosed as Wishcott-Aldrich syndrome. So if you are looking at a young baby with ITP, you always have to have this kind of differentials in mind. Of course, you don't work up straight away, but you definitely follow them closely, whether you need to do this kind of investigations in the follow-up. Connective tissue disorders you need to rule out, especially in adolescent age group. Chronic ITP chances are up to 20% in children, whereas as the age goes up, it can go up to 50% also. This is the work of what you have to go ahead and do in chronic ITPs. There are several second line medications as listed here. So the main dictum is treat the child, not the number. So that is the main dictum in the chronic ITP. Main day splenectomy, you have to go ahead after 1 year of age, not before. And that too, current 2019 ASH guidelines also says the same thing, that if you are failing to failing with the second line medical therapy, then you have to go ahead with the splenectomy, because even with the splenectomy, the response rate is seen only in 2/3 of cases. So these are the various indications for platelet transfusion, which you will go ahead and find in any of the books, but I'm not going into that. And definitely in an ITP, there is no role of platelet transfusion except you are facing a life-threatening bleeds. Thank you.
Thank you, madam. Thank you for this excellent talk and enlightenment on ITP. A lot of questions are there for you. So before that, there are total 120 attendees today, and that's a good response, madam. Next week also we are having e-webinar on cough, especially management of acute cough and management of chronic cough from our consultants. So few questions, madam. Especially all the hematologists say that platelet transfusion is of no value unless there is critical bleeding. How platelet transfusion helps in an already bleeding child? What is wrong if you give platelets when count is less than 20,000, even if there is no bleed? Dr. M.L. Maheshwaro, sir.
So as I just said, like the pathophysiology is mainly your platelets are getting destroyed because of the presence of autoantibodies in the system. So whatever you are transfusing, those antibodies also are going to get destroyed in the spleen, and it's not going to be useful. And as we all know, like sometimes transfusion can have its own risks and benefits. So if you are facing a life-threatening transfusion-related reaction with the platelet, especially platelets are stored at room temperature, like 23 to 24 degree temperature. So if you are going ahead and giving the platelets, and when it is not useful, if you are facing the reaction, definitely as a physician, you are accountable for all those kind of reactions. So why we go ahead and give in severe life-threatening bleeds and IC bleedies, even in those initial 4 to 6 hours when they are in the system, probably at that time they go and seal the bleeding point, and then probably it will help in, like, you know, controlling the further bleed in the CNS and limiting the disability. So those kind of concepts are there. In the severe mucosal bleed, definitely the initial platelet plug that forms even the initial few hours will be helpful to control the life-threatening bleeds where they are dropping the hemoglobin and all. So except that, especially IC bleed, except that platelets are not routinely indicated in ITP for transfusion.
Yeah, madam. Next thing for you only, madam, is may I know the reference of treatment schedule in ITP? I guess it is Indian Pediatrics General. It is there, right, madam?
Yes, in Indian Pediatrics, you have a publication in 2016. That yep. One of the tables what I have showed, like, you know, for steroid dosing, if you are giving for 1 week 1 mg/kg, tapering over next 3 weeks. If you are giving 2 mg/kg for 2 weeks, tapering over next 1 week. If you are giving pulse methylpred 30 mg/kg for 3 days, then 20 mg/kg next 4 days. So you can choose any of the schedules, but practically most of the times, like giving for 2 weeks and then tapering next 1 week is the practically adopted method many of us do. And there is also a definition, like, where you call it as steroid dependency. When steroid dependency is like, if you are you try to taper and stop at the end of 3-4 weeks and then they recur again and you have to go back onto the same treatment, you have to continue the steroids for 2 months, then it indicates that they have a steroid dependency, and then you may have to continue at very low dose and then put another second line drug. So you can have a different options at that time.
Yeah, madam. Is one second. Is there any role of combination? What is it?
Therapy.
Vijay, can you read that question, please?
Yeah. Is there a role of combination therapy like IVIG plus steroid or anti-D with steroid? Is the response rate faster with combination?
So if anywhere, as I showed earlier, the case scenario where you have IC bleed or life-threatening bleed, we don't know whether they respond to IVIG alone or they respond to steroid alone. So in those cases, definitely we go ahead and use the combination therapy, because any one of them will work and help in building up the platelet count. Otherwise, like, you are at risk of life-threatening situation. So in those cases, definitely one can go ahead and use the combination. But there are no publications to say that combination is better than single drug and all. So your efficacy of steroid is most, like, you know, renowned compared to other medications. Steroids are most effective drugs, like 80-85% of them they respond. IVIG 75-80% of them they respond. Anti-D around 60-70% of them respond. So for every medication you do have. Initially, when you fail to get response with steroid IVIG, then you go for anti-D rather than going upfront with the anti-D.
Yeah. Another question from Dr. Sitaram, sir, only. In children with chronic ITP who are asymptomatic with platelet counts of 15,000 to 20,000, can they be left alone or splenectomy considered?
So, sir, it all depends on, like, you know, how parents understanding whether they reach to, as per guidelines, if they don't have bleeding, you are not supposed to treat. So this is the guidelines. But in practical scenario, practically what we face in our clinical practice is, like, you know, child will be playing. And then we had one child while playing cricket, he had injury to eye. And then he came with big hematoma. There was also a worry that he had IC bleed and all. So we can get into situations like this. So to avoid those kind of scenarios, practically what we do is, if they can't reach the medical attention in a faster way, like they are living in a remote place or their understanding is not good, in chronic ITP, even with minor bleeding manifestations with a count of 15,000 to 20,000, we put them on medication to bring the count to safe range, like 30,000-40,000, and then continue the medication and wait for spontaneous recovery, because these medications are going to help through several mechanisms, like cutting down the autoantibodies or acting through T cells and then giving the less signals to B cells and producing less autoantibodies. So those kind of mechanisms are there. So that is all temporary. So this is only to buy the time. When you give medications, you are buying the time while waiting for spontaneous recovery. So that is the main principle of treatment. So if the parents are from the place where they can access the medical care immediately, and their education status understanding is good, and then when they know that when to come immediately for medical care, one can go ahead and wait easily. Like when you are facing 10,000 15,000, at times we do wait even 5,000 to 10,000 for chronic ITPs without bleeding. But if you are looking at a child, the scenario what I have seen given just now, So definitely we need to go ahead and keep them in safe range. About 30,000-40,000 is the safe, 30,000 is the safe range.
Vijay, that was an excellent presentation from you. One question for you, why there are two pathways for children? Why are they called intrinsic and extrinsic pathway?
It is mainly mostly based on the trigger which was triggering the event. Like if it is an extravascular event, the extrinsic pathway pitches in, and if there is any problem in the endothelium, if there is endothelium damage, the intrinsic pathway. The thing is, extrinsic pathway, as we seen, it is very fast, only one factor to activate this thing. For the intrinsic pathway, there are like multiple factors. So to say frankly, both the things will operate. But based on the trigger, what was the trigger? It depends. Ultimately, the thing has to be done is thrombin has to be activated and fibrin has to be produced.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Vijay. Thank you, Shirisha Madam, for your excellent presentation and enlightening on ITP. Thank you, Dr. Vijay. That's a nice presentation. And thank you all for your patient hearing. As Vijay said, there are series of webinars are going on, but there we see good response for these rainbow webinars. Please continue and please join us for the next week. Till then, goodbye and good night. Stay safe, stay home.
Good night. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you all. Good night.